I think it's fair to say former police officer Roger Rogerson is an evil man. A few hours ago, he was found guilty of murdering 20-year-old university student Jamie Gao. But there's much more to the Rogerson story. Publicly, he was a highly decorated star of the New South Wales Police Force, a man many viewed as a potential police commissioner. But that was all a lie. In reality, he was a bad cop, as crooked as can be. Tonight, a former good cop, Mick Drury, is speaking for the first time about Rogerson's involvement in the attempt to kill him. And Drury's account of his battle to expose Rogerson's corrupt ways is just the beginning of the real history of the most notorious rat in police ranks. This is the kitchen.
Yes, this is the kitchen. A couple of minor changes, but yes, this is the kitchen and the kitchen window, of course. And unfortunately, this is where it all happened.
And the gunman would have been right there?
Just the other side of the window, no more than a metre away.
The detective, a senior constable, had been standing at the kitchen sink of his Chatswood home shortly after 6 o'clock this evening when two shots were fired through the window.
It was the crime that rocked the nation. In 1984, a 31-year-old policeman is gunned down in his own home in front of his wife and two small children.
I remember the first shot hit me straight through the stomach. Into the area just next to the backbone and lodged between the ribs. And the second shot hit me alongside the heart and underneath the shoulder blade. And when it hit the shoulder blade, the percussion of it spun me around and I spun back about 3 metres and crashed into the wall.
The shooting of Mick Drury would become a classic Australian television drama, Blue Murder. But this was no Hollywood fiction. This was Sydney's reality in the 1980s. Thorn in my side, you know that's all you ever were. An extraordinary life and death battle between two detectives, undercover drugs cop Mick Drury, and a man some had thought could be the next police commissioner, Roger Rogerson.
This escalated to a level that had never been seen before in this country. This was like Chicago in the 1920s or Columbia in the 1990s, where life was cheap.
And policing had lost its way?
Policing hadn't lost its way, but certain individuals, Rogerson in particular, had lost his way. The essence basically is it was just a straight-out assassination of a young police officer at home in front of his family.
It's been 32 years since that night when Mick Drury stood here at the kitchen window of his family home and was gunned down in a crime that has never been solved. But tonight, Mick Drury takes aim. And for the first time, claims Roger Rogerson drove hitman Christopher Flannery to his home to shoot him. Christopher Dale Flannery pulled the trigger.
Correct.
But Roger Rogerson drove him to your house.
He actually drove the motor car that night. I have no reservations about that whatsoever. And it makes logical sense. To go in and do a job like that, you needed someone who could protect you so that you wouldn't be stopped by the police. And the perfect driver was Roger Rogerson.
Would have been in 1960 when I was doing weekend vice squad duty.
It is a breathtaking allegation. But the notion that Roger Rogerson could be the biggest rat in the police ranks comes as no surprise to many, including Sasha Huckstep.
This is a man who has ruined lives. He is a murderer. And he has abused the trust that was put in him being a serving police officer.
Sasha is the daughter of Sally Ann Huckstep, who in 1981 told 60 Minutes that Roger Rogerson had murdered her boyfriend, Warren Lanfranchi.
When the police become judge, jury, and executioner, then somebody has to speak. Somebody has to come forward. Somebody has to start somewhere and stop it.
It would be the first time many Australians would hear the name Roger Rogerson, and the first time the CIB detective would feel the uncomfortable prodding of public scrutiny. A few years later, Sally Ann Huckstep's body was found floating in Busby Pond Centennial Park in the heart of Sydney. Sasha Huckstep has always believed Roger Rogerson wanted her mother dead.
I believe that Rogerson had had enough, that he said that she had to go. He wanted her dead. He was being groomed for bigger and greater things. And, you know, I think that was a big part of his anger and resentment towards my mother. He was being groomed, you know, probably to be police commissioner, the way he was going. And once my mother spoke up, well, that was going to be a little bit difficult.
The murder of Sally Ann Huckstep and the shooting of Detective Mick Drury were two crimes which exposed the blurred lines between some police and Sydney's underworld. But no one crossed the line quite like Detective Roger Rogerson. What Rogerson hadn't anticipated was coming up against a cop like Mick Drury. Mick, why did you choose a life in the police force?
As a teenager growing up in Newcastle, it was important for me at the time to go into a vocation that had a future in it. And I really believe the police department, as a police officer, did. And it is, it's a wonderful vocation where you can help others in need.
But you were pretty young at the time.
19.
And in that short period, you developed a passion, it seems, for policing.
Well, I think to this day, I still have a passion for being a police officer.
A young Mick Drury was doing the most dangerous police work possible, as an undercover cop tracking the Mr. Biggs of the drug trade. And that meant you had to become someone you weren't.
Correct.
How hard is that?
It's difficult at first. It's difficult to be a gangster when you're not a gangster.
Keeping your mind on the job and not slipping up must have been really difficult when you were dealing with some very unsavoury characters.
It was, especially when you're using two or three names. You had to remember the right name for the right case.
But it was work Mick Drury excelled at. In 1981, he won the Peter Mitchell Award, the highest honour for New South Wales Police.
It was a very proud moment for my family and my friends and myself. Very proud moment.
Yet no one could know about it.
Correct.
It wasn't celebrated because you're an undercover cop.
Correct.
The applause had to be held within four walls, you know, at the family home.
I remember having a good cup of tea with Mum.
Ironically, a year earlier, the Peter Mitchell Award had been given to none other than Roger Rogerson. Had you heard of Roger Rogerson in your earlier years of policing?
I think every police officer knew of Roger Rogerson.
Indeed, I think at one point he was even considered the kind of police officer who could be the commissioner.
In the minds of some, yes, that would be the case. He was very powerful because of his political connections within the police department. Very powerful.
That power was first publicly questioned in 1981. When Roger Rogerson shot dead drug dealer Warren Lanfranchi in Dangar Place, Chippendale, an inner Sydney suburb. Rogerson claimed it was self-defence.
Warren Lanfranchi walked directly towards me, and then when he got to about here, he kept walking into the lane, into Beaumont Street, heading towards Dangar Place. And I could see a car coming down the hill, which I knew contained Detective Sergeant Harding and Detective Rod Moore. Well, because at that point of time, he was very, very toey, absolutely jumping. So he said words to the effect that it was an ambush, and I basically agreed with him. And because at that point of time, he then suddenly just backed around and pulled this gun out from these very tight trousers. And as he was bringing it up, I realised this bloke's going to shoot me. So I reached behind for my gun, and because I didn't mess around, and I brought it up and I fired one shot. And then fairly quickly after that, I fired a second shot. And of course, it killed him.
But a week after the shooting, Lanfranchi's girlfriend, Sally Ann Huckstep, went public on 60 Minutes and told Ray Martin a very different story.
Did Warren try to take his gun that Saturday morning or Saturday lunchtime?
Oh, God, no.
Sally Ann Huckstep, a self-confessed heroin addict and prostitute, claimed it wasn't a gun in Lanfranchi's pocket, but $10,000 of drug money to pay off Rogerson.
We had $10,000. Which we'd wrapped up into bundles with elastic bands right round. It was one big bundle. He put the money down the front of his pants and pulled his jumper down over the top of it.
How do you know, Sally, that he didn't have a gun in the car, that he didn't pick it up on the path as he walked out, that he didn't have it planted somewhere?
Because he left the gun at home and I had the gun. It was a 9mm Smith & Wesson automatic pistol.
And you had it after he left?
No question.
He was definitely armed.
With a 38?
Well, it wasn't a 38, it was a 32. I'm not quite sure. It was a Harrington and Richardson, anyhow. It was a Harrington and Richardson revolver.
And no money was ever found?
No, that's correct.
The go-between for that particular encounter was Nettie Smith.
That's correct.
What was his role in that?
Well, his role was to bring Lanfranchi to the vicinity of Dangar Place.
But Nettie Smith also testified that the frisking he gave Lanfranchi, he didn't have a gun in those skin-tight trousers.
Nettie Smith was a major drug dealer and an informant and drinking buddy of Roger Rogerson.
Do you know if Lanfranchi was carrying a gun?
Well, I patted him down, roughly, and he didn't have one on him that time.
He did not?
Well, I couldn't find it.
Could you hide a 38 in skin-tight trousers?
Very easily.
But you can't hide a packet of cigarettes in tight trousers. How could you hide a revolver?
Well, I'd say you could.
A coroner found Rogerson shot Lanfranchi whilst trying to arrest him, but the inquest jury declined to say it was in self-defence. At the time, Sasha Huckstep was just 8, but she says she remembers clearly what her mother told her.
Well, it was an ambush. It was a complete ambush.
And you never doubted your mother? You never doubted she was telling you the truth?
No. There was nothing to gain by lying. She was putting herself at risk.
It was a pretty extraordinary thing to do.
Yeah, very much.
In many respects, she was marking herself.
She was very brave, but I think also very naive. Very, very naive. I think she felt that by talking to you guys, that would keep her safe, that should anything happen to her, everybody would automatically look to Rogerson.
Had you any idea in those early days that he was a corrupt police officer?
I had very substantial concerns. I knew in those days that
the police officer-informant relationship, as it was so called, between Roger Rogerson and Eddie Smith was ethically very, very unhealthy. I knew then.
But Mick Drury is about to learn Rogerson's relationship with a drug dealer is not just unethical, it's deadly. Coming up, the day Mick Drury became a marked man.
You now know unequivocally Roger Rogerson is corrupt.
Gunned down in his home.
Dad wasn't quite sure whether he would ever see his two little girls again.
And his explosive allegation.
They were in a state of shock because they knew what I'd just said.
That's next on 60 Minutes.